God is dead is probably Nietzsche's most notorious soundbite. It's a statement that has saturated society as a cultural watershed moment. But the true meaning and power of Nietzsche's dynamite phrase has often been missed in popular culture. When you come across this statement in the varying corners of the culture, it is often taken as a pithy formulation of modernism's revolution. Taken this way, God is dead is really just a statement of something that had been brewing for centuries since Copernicus and Descartes. But that is not what Nietzsche was doing. God is dead isn't simply Nietzsche signing the death certificate of the Christian God. Atheism was nothing new in his time. It may have been controversial, but it was very far from the cutting edge. God is dead was not a stating of the obvious. It is a much more profound and a much more horrifying sentiment. When it comes down to it, this isn't a modernist statement, but a postmodernist statement. When Nietzsche says that God is dead, he doesn't just mean the Christian God is dead. God here doesn't refer to the narrow religious definition, but to the broader idea of the universal and transcendent truth. A more accurate way of expressing what he meant would be, truth is dead. It doesn't pack the same poetic punch, but the statement, truth is dead, captures more of the postmodern horror that Nietzsche was really getting at. In this episode, we're going to explore the meaning of this statement in depth, and what Nietzsche really meant, and why it was so much more revolutionary and groundbreaking than a mere statement of atheism. The madman. Have you not heard of that madman who lit a lantern in the bright morning hours, ran to the marketplace and cried incessantly, "I seek God, I seek God." As many of those who did not believe in God were standing around just then, he provoked much laughter. "Has he got lost?" asked one. "Did he lose his way like a child?" asked another. "Or is he hiding? Is he afraid of us? Has he gone on a voyage, emigrated?" Thus they yelled and laughed. The madman jumped into their midst and pierced them with his eyes. "Whither is God?" he cried. "I will tell you. God is dead. God remains dead. And we have killed him." In the setup of this aphorism, there is something that should immediately jar with an attempt to read this passage as modernist. The audience that the madman speaks to are not simple religious people. They are not priests or bishops or upholders of the religious order. This is what we'd expect of a triumphant modernist narrative, which calls the religious deluded and mocks their beliefs as insane. On the contrary, what we get is an audience of unbelievers who mock the madman in his search for God and ask him if God is lost or hiding. It's the same sort of condescending attitude you see with the likes of Richard Dawkins or Sam Harris. It's the crowd that see religious belief as a childish fairy tale at best, or a nefarious mind virus at worst. In speaking to such a crowd, Nietzsche is signalling something important. The counterposition to the madman is not the religious believer, but the modernist unbeliever. Which, if you think about it, makes sense. Nietzsche was at the cutting edge of dangerous thoughts, and by the time he's writing at the end of the 19th century, atheism was far from the cutting edge. Remember, this is already decades after Darwin had published On the Origin of Species, which was really the final nail in the Christian coffin. Proceeding beyond this declaration of God's death, Nietzsche paints a grim rhetorical image of doom. We have murdered God, and there is some consequence to be paid for this action that we haven't reckoned with just yet. This price is the real message of the madman. By killing God, we have exposed the devouring vacuum of nihilism. This is the warning that Nietzsche is trying to communicate to the modernist. The death of God presents a danger unheard of in the history of culture, and we ignore it at our own risk. The modernist mindset hears the phrase, "God is dead," and like the audience of Nietzsche's madman, they laugh and they mock. The death of God is a triviality. It is a non-event that we needn't worry about. It is a great event to have put away these superstitions. Now we are more intelligent, now we are smarter, and unlike our ancestors, we are no longer being duped into believing silly stories. The modernist laughs sardonically at the fate of the religious in their holy book and proudly holds up the scientific canon and all its amazing discoveries as a counter-argument. Science, great science, has liberated us from the stupidity of the ages. Needless to say, Nietzsche is not so optimistic about the modernist project. By the time of writing The Gay Science in 1882, Nietzsche has progressed beyond his earlier adulation of the scientific worldview. He is no longer infected with the enthusiasm of science and progress, but by this time he has begun to turn his maxims and arrows on the great mammoth that was modern scientific optimism. hence the madman's audience being not religious believers, but modernist atheists. A few years after the gay science and his declaration of God's death, Nietzsche takes aim at the place of science in his book On the Genealogy of Morality. In the third essay of the genealogy, he is exploring the topic of the ascetic ideal. This is the ideal of asceticism that Nietzsche sees as underlying the evolution of organized religion. The belief in true reality as a transcendental realm beyond this world is the hallmark of the ascetic ideal. In section 24 of this essay, Nietzsche says that he has looked around for a counter-ideal to this ascetic ideal, and he has found it everywhere lacking. He responds to the suggestion that science offers a counter-ideal, that it has already conquered the ascetic ideal in all important respects. All of modern science is supposed to bear witness to that. Modern science, which, as a genuine philosophy of reality, clearly believes in itself alone, clearly possesses the courage for itself and the will to itself, and has up to now survived well enough without God, the beyond, and the virtues of denial. The truth is precisely the opposite of what is asserted here. Science today has absolutely no belief in itself, let alone an ideal above it. And where it still inspires passion, love, ardour and suffering at all, it is not the opposite of the ascetic ideal, but rather the latest and noblest form of it. This is the beginning of Nietzsche's critique of science. He is not attacking science itself or scientists, for he says, "I approve of their work." What he is going after, though, is the jump between science and scientism, by which we mean Wittgenstein's suspicion of the attitude, the overestimation of science. This overestimation of science is what Nietzsche is tackling. He is not anti-scientific, for as we have noted, he approves of the work of scientists. But he is going after the worldview that evolves around science, the ideologizing of science. This attitude contains an idealization of science's capabilities. It enshrines science on the lofty pedestal once occupied by Christianity. Science becomes the new religion. So what Nietzsche is going after here is the atheistic science-loving type represented in the parable of the madman by those who laugh and mock him. The ironic thing about this type from Nietzsche's perspective is that they think they're the opposite of the religious mindset. When Richard Dawkins calls religion a delusion, it goes without saying that he is superior to the religious mindset, that his rational worldview is the opposite of this religious mindset. But the irony for Nietzsche is that they are not opposites, but merely varying manifestations of the same ascetic ideal. Science, like the ascetic ideal, still preaches another world, the objective world of things in themselves. The truthful man, in the audacious and ultimate sense presupposed by the faith in science, thereby affirms another world than that of life, nature, and history. And insofar as he affirms this other world, does this not mean that he has to deny its antithesis, this world, our world? It is still a metaphysical faith that underlies our faith in science, and we men of knowledge today, we godless men and anti-metaphysicians, we too still derive our flame from the fire ignited by a faith millennia old, the Christian faith, which was also Plato's, that God is truth, that truth is divine. But what if the belief is becoming more and more unbelievable? If nothing turns out to be divine any longer, unless it be error, blindness, lies, if God himself has turned out to be our longest lie? The fruit of questioning this ascetic ideal which underpins Christianity and science, and denying our faith in it, is that a new problem arises, that of the value of truth. The value of truth is something that we have taken for granted, but as Nietzsche notes, this faith is millennia old. It is the Christian faith which was also Plato's. He wants us to question the idea of truth's divinity. Exploring what this looks like is beyond the scope of this video, but a taster of what Nietzsche is talking about here is given in the first section of his work Beyond Good and Evil, where he asks why we should prefer truth to untruth, given that life is as reliant on untruth as it is on truth. Above truth, in Nietzsche's value scheme, we find life and health, and so, rather than focusing on the truth as the highest value, when looking at a belief or behavior, we are better off asking to what extent it is life-promoting, life-preserving, species-preserving, perhaps even species-cultivating. The bottom line is that Nietzsche sees science not as the opposite of the religious mindset, but as the latest manifestation of it. It is the obsession with the universal and transcendent truth that lies beyond these manifestations of the ascetic ideal. And so, when Nietzsche tells us that God is dead, he is not making a modernist attack on the religious mindset in the way that Dawkins or Dennett might. He is making a postmodernist attack on the modernist idolization of science. He wants to reveal that this worldview is the fruit of the same tree as the religious worldview. The true meaning of God is dead is much deeper than what had already become a platitude by the end of the 19th century. When Nietzsche uses the word God here, he's speaking of a broader faith, the Christian faith which was also Plato's, that God is truth, the truth is divine. The death of God is a potential calamity. To kill God in this broader sense is not just to do away with the mythos of Christianity. By throwing out the bathwater of God, we are also casting out our epistemic certainty and the grounding of truth. We are losing solid ground, and so we are threatened with the potentially devastating problems of nihilism and relativism. Without God, Nietzsche asks, is there still any up or down? Are we not straying as though through an infinite nothing? Do we not feel the breath of empty space? Has it not become colder? Is not night continually closing in us? Looking around him in the age of modernity, Nietzsche sees that this worry hasn't really dawned on his contemporaries, and he concludes that lightning and thunder require time. The light of the stars requires time. Deeds, though done, still require time to be seen and heard. This deed is still more distant from them than the most distant stars. 130 years on, it is worth contemplating whether this disaster has reached it yet, or whether Nietzsche's analysis was mere alarmism. Perhaps it is still too early to say. In the past decade, we have seen terms emerge like post-truth, which has been defined as the disappearance of shared objective standards for truth. In our warped intellectual landscape, where the waters of the epistemic commons grow muddier every day, it is worth reflecting on the warning of the madman. Nietzsche's true heirs in our time are the postmodernist thinkers, who have wrestled with the problem of relativism and the value of science, and for this dancing with dangerous questions, they, and postmodernism itself, have become boogeymen used to scare the population. In a closing note, it is worth noting that despite the great dangers of the situation, the sequence of breakdown, destruction, ruin, and cataclysm that is now impending, Nietzsche is optimistic. Indeed, we philosophers and free spirits feel when we hear the news that the old God is dead, as if a new dawn shone on us. Our heart overflows with gratitude, amazement, premonitions, expectation. At long last, the horizon appears free to us again, even if it should not be bright. At long last, our ships may venture out again, venture out to face any danger. All the daring of the lover of knowledge is permitted again. The sea, our sea, lies open again. Perhaps there has never yet been such an open sea. That's everything that I wanted to cover on today's episode of The Living Philosophy. If you have any thoughts, insights, or feedback, I'd love to hear from you down below. If you've enjoyed the video, please give it a like or a thumbs up down below, and subscribe if you're new to the channel. And otherwise, I shall see you next time. Thank you for watching.